everybody. This is Jeremy. I'm here with Seth from Becoming the Archetype. Seth, how you doing?
Good, good.
Nice to finally meet you, man.
Yeah.
I just was hoping maybe we could talk a little bit about the album. Mainly, I'm going to kind of stick it to the album, the new release. Can you kind of talk a little bit about the writing process? You know, was it different for this album from any of the previous albums? Just talk about that a little bit.
We wrote this album a lot live, so we ended up having a lot of time spent taking riffs to each other in the band and just writing in band practice. So we had actually a pretty even amount of writing this album. Like, we've had past albums where it'd be like one or two people wrote pretty much the entire album. But this album, like, Jason, the vocalist, Daniel, the other guitarist, and I were all really involved with everything that happened. So it took a long time. We wrote in a live setting, so when we went into the studio with Matt Goldman, we could play all the songs together, which was really refreshing for him, because normally bands can't do that when they come into the studio with them. So
cool. Now, what about like your influences for this record? What kind of influenced you guys for this record?
Well, I guess, like, without sounding arrogant,
okay.
I want to say that, like, usually we try to do something that's not too far removed from our back catalog, so that, okay, you know what I mean, so that we don't alienate previous fans. So that's obviously, you know, our back catalog is partly, you know, what we base our sound on, but also our new guitarist Daniel really brought like a new injection and energy into the band, and so he listens to a lot more modern metal than we do. Like, Jason and I and Duck, we listen to pretty much the same bands you always have, like old school Christian metal bands like Living Sacrifice, Zao, you know, Extol, bands like that. But also, like, I listen to like a lot of Opeth and Mastodon, bands like that. Daniel is more likely to listen to someone like The Faceless, you know, or I mean, like some New Sumerian or Rise Records, you know, some band like that. So we had actually a lot of influences. Production quality was a lot like the new Opeth album. We were able to show Matt Goldman, our producer, like what their album sounded like. He's like, dude, this sounds great. Like, we should do something in the vein of this style of, you know, the sound for the guitars and stuff. So, we ended up doing a lot of stuff that I don't think the other people will notice our influences as much. Man, we were really stoked with how Matt Goldman saw, you know, what we wanted to do and came out with it. So
cool. I'm actually gonna have to refer to this real quick. I read a little quote online on your guys' Wikipedia page. I want to kind of get your ideas of it. But it said, the record will include many new concepts, including parts with sitars and trombones. Can you elaborate on that a little bit? What new concepts and kind of what songs will we hear those on?
We just had a whole slew of world instruments on this album. So it's pretty awesome. We got, I'd wanted to do sitar on our previous album, Dichotomy, and it just didn't work out. We couldn't get anyone in time. This album, it did work out. We had a friend that lives in Chicago, and we drove him down and got him to play sitar on two tracks. One is just a sitar track. There's like a 43-second track called Invisible Creature. Just tablas and sitar, like Eastern, you know, instruments. And then he played just some little things on another longer metal track. We got trombones from two different guys. One of them's here tonight at the show, actually. He played trombone for the intro track, and then another guy played trombone for the song Cardiac Rebellion, which has a ska section at the end of the song. That was exciting. That guy is actually Dennis Culp, who from Five Iron Frenzy, and Five Iron Frenzy was a big, you know, favorite band of ours.
Okay.
So getting him to play trombone on the album was kind of a dream. Cool. So we were able to incorporate a lot of things that we felt like you weren't going to hear on another metal record. So that's cool, you know.
Yeah. Now, can you tell me a little bit about the meaning of the title of the album? And can you explain the cover art a little bit?
Yeah, it all kind of goes together. It's a unified image. The cover art is this figure. It's a painting by Dan Seagrave, and Dan Seagrave's a great artist. He did Terminate Damnation. He did some Demon Hunter albums. it's a painting of this figure, like a phoenix, rising out of the ocean, and he's on fire, shafts of light shooting out. So that's the front, and that is a picture of the meaning of the term celestial completion, meaning we're looking forward to the completion of ourselves spiritually. And that's part of the whole concept of the album lyrically, is that at the end of the world, it's like a positive spin on the end of the world. It's like the end of the world's coming, but it's not a bad thing. It's okay, you know? And that actually reflects to what we have on the back of the album. The back of the CD is a picture of us levitating, and we're like rising up. And so it's kind of like a moment of promise for us, and saying like we finally get to find our completion as individuals and find out who we really are. You know, it's a moment of unveiling. Is could be a really good thing. So that's it's. I know lots of metal bands write songs and albums about the apocalypse, but this is like the other. This is like the good opposite, apocalypse.
Yeah. Okay. And how would you say you guys' music has evolved over the years since you guys formed back in '99?
From 99 to 2004, it changed a lot, because in 99, it was just some of the guys playing, and they went through like a bunch of different names. They went through hardcore and all kinds of different, you know, everything.
Yeah.
And around 2004, it started to solidify into a metalcore-ish sound, you know, and that's when I joined the band. We changed our name to Become the Archetype. I added keyboards. We signed to Solid State, started touring. So a lot of stuff changed right there.
Okay.
So we kind of got into like a pretty good like metalcore groove, and then after Terminate Damnation, we went to really like black metal and tech metal with Physics, which is probably a misstep. it was kind of a weird album for us. But since then, we've kind of fallen into a prog metal sort of sound, with really just an emphasis on good songwriting and even some elements of just rock. You know what I mean? So we actually have a lot of sections that we'll call, like when we're writing the song, we're like, oh, that's the Rob Zombie section, or, you know, that's the Disturbed riff, or, you know, whatever. So we go for like a more of like a prog rock, prog metal feel now. You know, I play a lot of organ stuff now on the albums, you know, to kind of give it that Rush / Opeth feel or whatever, you know. So yeah, that's really where we're going now.
Okay. And I'm going to ask you, what are your three favorite tracks? If you had to pick three, what are your three favorites off the new album and why?
Off the new album, I like the last track a lot. It's called Breathing Light. It's a longer song. It's like 6.5 minutes, I think.
Okay.
But I like it because we've never done a track like this before. I had bought, before we started writing, I bought a Line 6 delay pedal. And I love U2. I love bands who use, like 80s bands use a lot of delay on the guitars. I was like, man, I would love to write a riff with this. So I came up with this cool lick that the whole song is built around. And we've never done anything like a U2 type of like lick with a ton of delay on it. So I love that. It's a really powerful song. Really well, really flows really well. I would say another track I like is Elemental Wrath. It's track 6, and it's the middle of a suite that we have. It's called Requiem Eternum, parts 1, 2, and 3. It's like a trilogy of songs.
Okay.
It's really long. It's 7.5 minutes.
Wow.
And it's got a ton of stuff. The first riff reminds me of what I like about Opeth, which is cool. It's got some vocoder vocals like Mastodon would use. It's got a long piano section I have, like we did an Elegy, you know, and it's got a lot of the elements that I think we do best, you know. And then I guess if you're asking me, I really like the track Invisible Creature, which is track 8, and it's just that 43 seconds of sitar and stuff, because man, I'm a big Beatles fan, and being able to have an actual sitar player come in and do an Eastern track on the album was like so cool to me, you know what I mean? Like, it was just like, I can't believe this is happening. I was like filming while it's going on. I'm like, this is happening. We have this guy in the studio, you know? So it's probably not going to be that interesting for a lot of people. It's going to be like, oh, it's the short instrumental track. But for me, it's just so cool, you know? So
That's cool. Now, do you guys have a support tour planned for the release of the album?
Well, that's kind of what we're on now. We're on, this is the first night of our CD release tour.
Okay.
And it's just 6 dates long. So it's just like, you know, playing a few CD release shows, you know. Then we're going to go out in April and May as well. Late April, like April 22nd through May 7th, like a 2.5 week run, mainly around the Midwest and East Coast. And that's not technically a CD release tour, but a lot of the promoters want to call it that because they're like, it's your first show here since your CD came out. So, that's, and then in the summer we have some stuff lined up, and we're going to Europe in the fall, and just, lots of stuff.
Okay. Any any support bands you can name for any of those tours yet?
Man, I wish I could, because in the summer we're doing a Solid State tour with all Solid State bands. But the thing is, one band that we thought was on the tour may end up not being on the tour, so I don't want to announce it.
Gotcha.
But yeah, it's going to be some good bands. I know that we'll have the Famine on part of it or all of it, and they're awesome guys, good musicians. To Speak of Wolves will be on all of the tour, and like those guys. And then there's one or two other bands I'm still waiting to hear. Actually, I should hear tonight confirmation.
Okay, cool. Is there any specific, like, one individual song off of the new record you're just dying to play live?
Man, I really wish we could play Breathing Light live, but we're not going to be able to, because, man, Daniel and I both have to sing on it. We sang on all the singing parts on the album.
Okay.
And normally, on most of the sections, we can sing and play, okay. But man, on Breathing Light, we tried it. I was like so stoked about playing it live. And so we started trying to, like, okay, now that we're done with it, we got to remember to play this and this and this.
Yeah.
And trying to play and sing it, which it was awful. Like, I was either messing up on guitar trying to focus on the vocals or hitting the wrong pitches singing because I was focusing on guitar. So,
okay.
Yeah. So we won't get to, we might do it eventually, but not anytime soon.
Okay. Now, what about, like, you know, all your album catalog there? Do you have a specific song that you just love playing live?
Man, Necrotizing Fasciitis is really fun live. It's not on an album, it's just a digital single that we did. But man, it's only 2.5 minutes long, and it's just, you know, really, really brutal grind stuff all the way through, and it's, we're actually going to open with it tonight.
Okay.
Yeah,
cool.
It's real fun. We talked about how it's really brutal, and it's like the most brutal thing we've ever done, and we talked about how funny it would be to just, like, tonight throw everyone for a loop and play it all on, like, clean guitar and, like, piano and sing the vocals. So, like, 1, 2, 3, 4, Necrotizing Fasciitis, and, you know, and, like, singing instead of screaming, like, the whole way through, and, like, it would be so funny to us, but I don't think people would get it, so we kind of fit the idea.
Okay. Let's see. And that's kind of going on my next question. What can we kind of expect to hear tonight? I mean, is it going to be quite a good amount off the new record, some old kind of...
Actually, it'll be a pretty good mix. We're going to play 3 songs from the new record. I actually wanted to do 4 or 5, but we've actually had some weird things with practice recently, like trying to... Our standard for the last 2 or 3 albums has been that we want the best thing on the CD that we can get, whether we can play it live or not. So we can play it live when we go into pre-production, then record, and we add all these layers onto the recording. And so once we get done with the record, we're like, well, man, how are we going to try to pull this off, you know? Yeah. So right now there's really only 3 that we can pull off really well, and we're trying to figure out a way to do another song or two.
Okay.
But tonight, we'll probably just play 3 songs live. Probably going to play 3, maybe 4 from Dichotomy.
Okay.
Play Necrotizing Fasciitis. We're playing 1 from Terminate Damnation. And then we may or may not, just depending on what happens with Physics. We didn't get to practice our song from Physics of Fire, so if we have to play another one, we'll play it, but it'd probably be pretty sloppy.
Okay. Let me ask you, what are your personal, you know, do you have any albums that you're really anticipating this year coming out?
Yeah. Man, this year's going to be awesome, actually. Opeth should be coming out with an album this year. I wouldn't be surprised if Mastodon does. I haven't heard about it, but they're probably going to be due by the end of the year. And then, like, non-metal bands, I have Blink-182 is coming out with one. Radiohead already apparently came out with one that I heard was not that great, but I think it's available online tomorrow, the same day as ours is.
Okay.
Coldplay's going to come out with one this year. And then there one of Jack White's bands, I think, is going to come. Like, the Dead Weather, Raconteurs, or someone is going to have another album out this year. So, yeah, there's actually 7 or 8 CDs I'm actually really excited about this year. So, yeah,
cool.
It's going to be a good year in music, I hope.
Definitely. Good. And, I mean, that's all the questions I've got for you, Seth. Do you have any final words for the fans who might be watching this video online?
Man, I'm actually, I'm just really stoked about Celestial Completion, and I think that if you buy it, you're not going to be disappointed. But also, if you listen to heavy music, chances are that you have a lot of aggression, you know, and a lot of angst. And I think that enough bands try to capitalize on that, and we're gonna try to just have fun, you know. So you're gonna see it at our shows, and you're gonna hear it on the album. We're about having fun, so we're gonna have a lot of fun. And I think that you'll see it in the music, you'll read it in the lyrics, and you'll see it at the shows. So we're about having fun, heavy music.
Cool. So. You heard it right there, man. Fun it is.
Fun it is.
We'll be having fun tonight, man. Thank
awesome,
you,
man. Awesome, dude.
Thank you. This is One Way Marketing.